Hello and welcome to West Wind, an audio podcast about cancer, technology in medicine, and policy issues. I'm host and medical oncologist, Dr. Jack West, from the City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center in the Los Angeles area. You can find West Wind material at beaconmedic.com, at iTunes, or just about anywhere you get podcast content. I would just ask that you show your interest and support by subscribing, commenting, sharing by telling friends and colleagues in person and on social media, and rating it however you feel is appropriate. You can also share your ideas and opinions by emailing us at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. My guest today is Dr. Ann Tsao, who is a professor in the Department of Thoracic and Head and Neck Medical Oncology, the Division of Cancer Medicine at the University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center in Houston, Texas. She is also the director of the Mesothelioma Program there and the director of thoracic chemoradiation at MD Anderson. So thank you so much. Obviously, a lot to do there.
Thank you so much, Jack. It's a pleasure to be here with you tonight.
Let's start with going back to just where did you grow up and were you interested in medicine from a very early age or did that come later? Can you tell us a bit about your childhood?
Well, I actually grew up in the suburbs of Chicago and my parents thought for sure I would be a vet because I used to bring stray animals home that I found and I would always feed them and if they needed medical attention, I used to pretend that I knew what I was doing and take care of them. Of course, my parents always ended up taking the animals to a vet, but I like to think that I fixed them. Mm-hmm. So I think I always was very interested in the natural sciences. But my father was an electrical engineer. My parents are immigrants from Taiwan, mm-hmm. and they're from a very small mountain village up in the mountainous area of Taiwan. Mm-hmm. And so my dad got a scholarship to the United States, and he got his PhD here. And then he was teaching at University of Illinois. And so that's why I grew up in Illinois. I'm a typical Midwest girl. Mm-hmm. When I grew up, we didn't lock our doors. We knew all our neighbors. And so it seemed really natural for me to think about electrical engineering because that's what my dad did. Mm-hmm. Or what my mother wanted me to do was fashion design. But that never worked out, so.
Now, she does this. Is this a career or just a hobby?
My mother's actually an artist. She used to teach biology in Taiwan, and then she taught art. And so now she does a lot of historical costuming, and she shows down in Chicago. She does a lot of work with the Taiwan societies, and they travel the world, you know, with their choir and with their costumes.
And she makes some amazing outfits for you.
She does, when I'm lucky enough, and she's not mad at me, yes.
Okay. So, I mean, you still have and wear some of her creations, right?
I do, all the time.
What was it like growing up with your cultural background? I don't know if you have family and would go to Taiwan ever growing up or spoke in the house, or did you identify much with, you know, with your Taiwanese culture in Chicago, or did you want and your family want and expect you to just assimilate into the broader American culture?
Well, I think my parents were quite different from the usual culture in Taiwan, where family was everything and you always stayed close by to your family. I have a very, very close-knit extended family in Taiwan. And so we would go for the summers, and I would spend my summers there with my extended family. But my parents were very innovative in their thinking in that they thought that the future would be in America for science, technology, for opportunity. They wanted my brother and I to have a very worldly education. They used to make me go to Chinese school on Sundays. So I had to learn Chinese, and my mother was hoping I would learn Japanese as well. Again, that didn't work out. I was quite a disappointment for her from that aspect.
But do they still speak it?
Oh, well, we spoke Taiwanese growing up at home, or Mandarin. And so it's funny, my husband, who is Caucasian, he's gotten to the point where he now understands our conversations because my parents speak Taiwanese to me and I'll speak English back to them. So he gets half the conversation from our family dinners.
It's like subtitling.
Yes, and he's learned a little bit of our language as well. But my parents obviously do speak English, and so, but one thing that I always found so challenging is that there are certain connotations or phrases or meanings from, you know, one language that you can't directly translate into another. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes I find myself, oftentimes, when I'm speaking now with my husband or my parents, where I'll be throwing in words from all these three different languages.
Mm. Your mother is an artist, your father, much more technical STEM background. Did you ever have any pull into the artistic world?
No.
Okay. It's a
not
fair
at
answer.
All.
Yeah. Oh, you wear it well.
Well, thank you. I think that just comes from my mother's ingrained style that, you know, she enforced on me. But I was never very good at art.
Okay.
So I realized very early on, long before my mother did, that I had very little artistic talent.
I presume your mother wasn't crushed that you were going into, yeah, medicine.
You know, she was for the first... Well, so initially, when I went to MIT, the goal was for me to do some type of engineering, because that's what the school was known for. That's what my parents were hoping that I would do. In fact, I had written a paper. My very first paper was actually with my father on electrical engineering. Mm-hmm. So they were hoping that I would take to that. But I'd always had this interest in the natural sciences. It was a natural progression for me to do pre-med as well. I did a lot of political science, you know, while I was at MIT too.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about that. I know you had been at MIT. First of all, did you feel any challenges, particularly as a young woman growing up and doing pre-engineering, you know, the math and the science? Did you have the sense of being discriminated against, or did you feel open opportunities?
So I was a little unusual. I went to college when I was 16. So I was quite young, which also drove my mother crazy because I did not tell them I was applying to college and skipping a grade in high school until it was done.
Bold.
And I know my parents were shocked and
so
a
you were
concerned.
Living in Boston basically on your own at 16.
Yeah, and it was...
Should say Cambridge.
Quite a growing experience.
Yeah.
So I always was very eager, you know, to get to that next level, to do the next thing. And so for me, I didn't find that MIT was strange, even though, yes, women were a minority there, particularly in the science and technology area.
Yeah, I mean, I have a good friend and who went to MIT at the same time as me, and I know several people who went there, and of course, you know, it was quite skewed towards men.
It was, but I think that that made the women become more close.
Okay.
Like some of my very best friends in my life are still my friends, my girlfriends from MIT.
Mm-hmm.
And I joined a sorority, which was helpful in making friendships. And these are lifelong friendships. So I think that being at MIT was incredibly important for not only my personal development and my growth, but also for my social network.
Excellent. Now, you'd mentioned that you married a Caucasian man. Were you or your family expecting, hoping to have you marry someone of a similar background, Chinese, Taiwanese, or were you and they totally open and not concerned about that?
My parents were totally open and not concerned. They're actually very American now because they've been here for 30-some-odd years. My extended family, I think, particularly my grandfather's level, of course, we're expecting at least to marry somebody within our culture. So, nevertheless, you make your choices and your family is your family.
Absolutely. They can come with you or not.
Exactly.
Okay. Now, what led you into oncology specifically? And maybe you can talk a bit about when you pivoted from engineering into medicine and that process. And then ultimately, what led you to the field of cancer care?
Well, I quickly realized at MIT that I'm not a very good engineer. And so that led me to say, I think I need to think about other options.
Trial by fire. There,
exactly. Yeah. And so medicine just seemed very natural to me. I understood it. I was fascinated by biology, genetics. You know, this was suddenly a very clear path for me. So I can't say there was one particular thing that led me to go down the medicine path. Once I was in medicine, I honestly knew that I would subspecialize, but I wasn't sure what. And then when I was in medical school, my grandmother came down with lung cancer. And she was a never smoker, Asian lady. And I was very close to my grandmother during all those summers that I would go there. Every morning, she would take me down to the local farmer's market, and we would shop in the morning and go back and have breakfast. And I was very close to her. And so when she developed the lung cancer, of course, it was very shocking. This was long before the era where people understood about EGFR mutations, much less targeting EGFR mutations. And she died before having the ability to be treated with that, a targeted therapy. And so I think that that led me to know that I wanted to invest my time and energy in oncology to make a difference.
And what led you to Houston, MD Anderson? Obviously a big change from, you know, living in Chicago or Boston, which are, you know, arguably more similar than different, at least.
I made my way southwest.
Yeah. So what was that pull?
So MD Anderson was always known as a fantastic oncology hospital. And so when I was looking at different options, they had a great fellowship program. They also were just on the cutting edge of targeted therapies. This was back when imatinib was just coming out for CML. And I had read a lot of papers, you know, coming out of MD Anderson. And I actually went to MD Anderson hoping to be a transplanter and a leukemia physician.
I noticed that you have a bunch of publications
in
leukemia,
yes.
CML.
When I was a fellow, that's what I did my work in. And my continuity clinic was also in stem cell transplant. And we could cure cancers there. And that was so appealing to me. And it was such a remarkable feeling to be able to sit across from somebody and be like, we did it and we cured you. But at the time I joined MD Anderson, when I, on day one, they assign you a mentor. And so my mentor was the late Wong Ki-hong. And he was a thoracic oncologist, thoracic head and neck medical oncologist. And as I went through my first year, year and a half, I was productive. Mm-hmm. And so he felt that we needed somebody to do targeted therapies in lung. Now, this was, again, before the era of targeted therapies, TKIs in lung. But he always had a vision, and he always was forward-thinking. And he and I were very close and ran his clinic for 3 years. And he really wanted me to join thoracic. I told him that was the one department I would not join because I watched my grandmother suffer and die from lung cancer, and I didn't want to be a part of that. And then he had me come into the office one day, and he said, you're going to be joining MD Anderson as a faculty member in thoracic, and you're going to cure people.
Well, that's bold.
He was the division chief of cancer medicine at the time, and he made the decisions about who gets hired and who doesn't. So that was my option. So I waved goodbye to leukemia, stem cell transplant, and I joined thoracic.
Were you, at that point, wary, reluctant about that, or were you more welcoming?
I think that I trusted his judgment.
Okay.
And he told me there was an opportunity, and he told me that there was a way to do this.
Now, you worked alongside of several of my colleagues I've known a long time, Ed Kim, I believe Fatlo Curry also was while you were there. But, you know, amazingly, I don't think there's any place like MD Anderson where I have worked generally in places where I am the primary or only person doing lung cancer. But at Anderson, you can be one of a dozen to two dozen people in the room who all have an expertise in this. Can you talk about what it's like to cultivate a career focus and an identity and an ego in a place where you're cheek to jowl with more than a dozen other people who are high-powered subspecialists in thoracic oncology at a very renowned cancer center?
Right. So I have close to 18 to 24 clinical partners that all do thoracic or head and neck, or both. And some of them are world-renowned in what they do. And so this is where, this is the remarkable privilege of working at MD Anderson, is that you get to work with these people, and you also get the opportunity to subspecialize and really learn a niche within a niche. And that makes you potentially then a world's expert in that. You have to view it that way and check your ego at the door and understand that you can't be it all. If you do that, you're going to be highly successful. If you are unable to do that, it becomes challenging because then you view others as competition. And that doesn't work for a group. It's not effective. It's also not in your best interests. And your partners are there to help you. the senior members of the department, of which now I'm a senior member, it's our responsibility to bring the next generation up and to make sure that they have niches and interests that they can be very successful in, they can build careers in, and make a huge impact in the field. I find that, for instance, I sort of differentiated very quickly into multimodality treatments and also for lung cancer and then also for mesothelioma and thymic carcinomas. These were wide open niches. They needed it to be filled. It was challenging because it's hard to get funding for these more rare tumors. It's challenging because you have to work in a multidisciplinary setting. But to be honest, I would never have been able to have done or built the programs that I did without the people that were there.
So your focus in mesothelioma, for instance, which is a particularly challenging one, that was you seeing the need and the opportunity to fill that void?
Well, we had several patients in Dr. Ki-Hong's clinic that had mesothelioma, so it was so different than non-small cell. And so I just started doing some preliminary research in it. I thought that there may be something to an anti-angiogenic pathway, targeting the different molecules there. And then that spanned into, ultimately, what we're doing now with immunotherapies. And I have a tremendous collaborator at MD Anderson, Ignacia Wastuba, who's a molecular pathologist who also had an interest in mesothelioma. And then we had an entire team of close to, you know, probably close to 30 different disciplines of people interested in mesothelioma that were willing to, you know, spend extra blood, sweat, and tears to get trials off the ground and do correlative translational work. And so it sort of became a natural progression.
I think the challenges in mesothelioma are pretty unique in that it's a small population. And now we're focusing more and more on other small populations. It can be looking at med exon 14 or RET or other few thousand patients here and there. But unlike many of these others where you're talking about, these are often the healthiest, youngest patients, most mobile and internet savvy. Mesothelioma is a smaller population that is very geographically dispersed, often older, many comorbidities, and I would imagine that the vast majority don't have the health or resources to get to a center like MD Anderson. So, you know, how feasible is it to A, do these trials in more than a few dozen patients, and B, do the results in these patients work in the far-flung locations of the world where the patients are coming in a wheelchair and they're 84?
No doubt about it. It's a challenging disease, but this is also where there's a great need. And this is where we need to invest resources, time, science, and we need to understand the biology of this disease better. It's a highly immunogenic tumor, but we don't have the typical biomarkers from the other solid tumors that correlate. And so it's incumbent on us to figure out what makes this disease immunogenic and what we can do to target it. It's not going to be straightforward or simple, but that's part of the challenge.
Mm-hmm. Are there many patients who do come from a great distance, you know, learning about things online and come for multimodality therapy options?
They most absolutely do. We get patients from all around the world. I routinely get emailed by people from various places throughout the world. There are many patient advocacy websites, MRF, Mesothelioma Applied Research Foundation being one of them. And they actually do try to help patients and get them connected with centers that are referral centers for mesothelioma.
The MAPS trial came out of Europe several years ago and looked at cisplatin pemetrexed with or without bevacizumab, and it demonstrated a statistically, but I would say also arguably clinically significant improvement in overall survival of over 3 months. But despite that benefit with bevacizumab, it's not FDA approved. And I think its application out in the world is quite variable. Do you consider the triplet to be the optimal standard of care right now? And, you know, any insights about this gulf between the data and the current standards?
So the IFCT ran the trial in France, and it did take them a long time to do the study. So unfortunately, many of the patients early on in the trial were still using paper charts. And so as a source document, it was difficult to turn that into a registration trial, which is why it never made it for FDA approval. It was submitted, but subsequently, because of the source documentation issue, it didn't progress for approval. So that has nothing to do with the actual data, though. And so I believe, as you do, that there's something there. There's definitely a tail end of the curve of these patients that do gain benefit. And it's actually important in many areas of the world that this be utilized, because you can't use maintenance pemetrexed in many places in the world for mesothelioma. The standard is cisplatin pemetrexed for 4 to 6 cycles, and that's it. I think there's something to be gained for some patients with maintenance therapy, whether it be pemetrexed or bevacizumab. And so I like having that as an option for patients. I definitely think that there's a population which we haven't been able to figure out or select for yet with a biomarker who gain significant benefit with the bevacizumab, because I have had some of them who are on it for years.
The FDA just recently gave an approval for tumor-treated fields. This was a device approval, and it was based on a phase 2 single-arm study with 82 patients, I believe. And the median overall survival was actually a little less than with bevacizumab. What role do you see this having in the universe of options that we now have?
So the STELLAR trial was conducted almost all in Europe. And so we have very little experience with TTF fields in the United States. From what I understand, it's for transducers that are placed on the thorax of the body. It's not without some toxicity. You do get dermatitis. A certain percentage has grade 3 dermatitis from this. You have to wear these transducers for long hours of the day. So it's cumbersome. And like you mentioned, the median overall survival was close to 18 months, which is similar to what we can achieve with bevacizumab triplet or maintenance pemetrexed. And so my thought is that I think it's great that the FDA gave an approval for something that can potentially be used in mesothelioma, but it should always be considered as an adjunctive therapy. It should never be used to replace therapy.
So one of my questions when thinking about the FDA is, does this imply it's a new standard of care, or is it an option? I think in this case, it's really something to consider. It broadens the options, but it shouldn't be connoted to represent a new standard.
I agree, because we also know with a small, 83-patient trial, that single arm, that you can definitely have problems. You get some bias, you get some patients who are wearing the transducers who maybe they take better care of themselves. I mean, it's a very small trial to base a standard of care on.
I have worked with and cared for a lot of patients with mesothelioma over the years, nowhere in the range of what you do, but I have worked closely with Dr. Eric Valliere, who is an exceptional thoracic surgeon who has a lot of experience with mesothelioma, as does Alex Farivar, who also works in Seattle, where I was. And, one question that I certainly struggle with and we debate is how much of the potentially very good outcomes that can occur with an aggressive surgery or multimodality approach of chemotherapy with or without bevacizumab, followed by surgery or various other protocols that are quite aggressive, are because of the aggressive interventions or because of the selection bias of these very non-representative patients who are candidates for multimodality therapy. Even to the question of, or the point of, are we potentially curing any of these patients, or are we just debulking the best patients anyway, to the point that they will still almost invariably relapse years, if not months later? So can you give some thoughts about the way you frame your discussions with patients and how much you think the better outcomes in many of these trials is selection bias versus aggressive? Is it cause or effect?
So I tend to believe it's a bit of both. I think that the patients who are hardy, who have good protoplasm, that are the ones that are candidates for multimodality therapy, are oftentimes the ones that have more indolent disease. And those are the ones that we still, as of yet, don't have a predictive biomarker from their tumor that can determine those. So I think it's a combination of biology and also aggressive treatment. And what is of essential, in fact, I would say what's critical, is that we have to figure out a way to identify these patients. And then for the patients who tend to have a little bit more aggressive therapy, this is where I think the era of immunotherapy will be of most use. Because if we can debulk these patients down to microscopic disease and we can find a way that we could augment the immune response afterwards, whether it be from combination immunotherapy or targeted combination immunotherapy, remains to be seen. But I think that we will improve the odds for these patients. And I know that some people say that you can never cure a mesothelioma, but I would argue that we may not be able to cure it yet. But if we can keep these patients going, maintain their quality of life, and keep their disease controlled so that they have no organ damage, as we learn more about the science and we have more things that may potentially be able to be used against them, we can oftentimes get them through to that next birthday, that next wedding. The next thing you know is a few years. And so I always have hope for my patients that we'll be able to make some progress during their life.
What do you consider the role for immunotherapy to be today in mesothelioma management?
No doubt about it, it should be incorporated at some point in their treatment. We don't have very good predictive biomarkers, as we mentioned. So I'm willing to try an immunotherapy on every mesothelioma patient. Whether or not they should be receiving this with chemo up front, similar to the DREAM trial that was presented by Australia recently, I'm not sure. And we still need some additional results from their trial from Australia, as well as from the pre-ECOG study, about whether combination chemoimmunotherapy is going to work like it does in non-small cell. But without a doubt, Japan's leading the way. They recently gave regulatory approval to nivolumab at the end of last year. It's expected the FDA as well as EMA are going to follow as soon as some of the larger phase 3 trials read out. There's without a doubt a population of patients that gain significant benefit from the immunotherapies.
What do you predict will be the standard of care in mesothelioma in, say, 3 years?
Well, my hope is that we'll be looking at combination immunotherapies. The MAPS2 trial will be recently coming out in Lancet Oncology. They're looking at the combination of ipilimumab, nivolumab, and then also nivolumab arm. As I mentioned, whether it's the patients who have high PD-L1, it's not a great predictive marker for meso, but it's all we have at the moment. We may be able to get immunotherapy frontline and reserve the chemo for later.
Thanks so much for joining me. It's been a great conversation.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening. The West Wind Podcast is a Beacon Medical Interchange production with sound engineering and distribution by Mark Lindsay of Talking Speaker. We hope you'll be motivated to subscribe, whether at beaconmedic.com, through iTunes, or through another podcast service. Please also rate it, and I hope you'll be inclined to tell friends and colleagues in real life and on social media. We're always happy to get your suggestions and other input at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Talk to you again soon.